Equipped with a parachute, life raft, locator beacons, and flares, the solar pilot must be prepared for the unexpected.
Thank you. Super. Thank you very much.
Solar Impulse is not equipped with an autopilot, but it does have a stability augmentation system that keeps SI2 on the same heading while the pilot takes 20-minute sleep breaks. An essential innovation is the monitoring and alerting system developed by our partner Altron, which alerts the pilot in case of any abnormal aircraft behavior.
So when the pilot is sleeping and we have an emergency, we have three steps of solution. The first one is the inboard monitoring alarm system, which automatically feels if there is a technical trouble with the aircraft. The second way is initiated from the mission control center. It's arm cuffs. They are vibrating and they will wake up the pilot. And the third case, if this is not working, maybe for a technical reason, we have an alarm sound that we can initiate from the cockpit, also a very loud alarm. So then the pilot will wake up for sure.
In most eventualities, the pilot will be able to quickly correct the path of the aircraft. But what would happen if, for example, SI2 had to land in the ocean? There's a high risk of electric shock in water landings, so the safest procedure for the pilot is to bail out of the cockpit, something that the pilots have trained for in several stages. Ejecting the cockpit door was tested in a wind tunnel to ensure a quick and clean separation from the frame. The pilots both practiced their freefall technique, getting used to the parachute that's built into the cockpit seat.
We integrated the parachute and life raft into the pilot seat to offer the pilot the ability to have more comfort. So between the pilot and his rescue equipment is the actual cushion of the seat. So he doesn't feel the weight of the parachute on his back and the life raft. It also offers him the ability to recline the seat fully, and the parachute and life raft remain inside the seat, and the pilot can still remain in a flying position. So he doesn't have that weight on his back, he's able to be flexible, he can rest on his right side and his left side, he can do exercises, and then if he has to have an emergency and bail out, he can pull the parachute, the life raft, they come to his back, and then he takes it with him. So he has a higher level of flexibility, comfort, but he still at all times has all of his rescue gear attached to his body and his person. If the pilot bails out and ends up in the water, he first has to get into his survival raft. Once safely in his survival raft, he has a bag full of all sorts of different survival equipment, the most important of which is to activate his personal locator beacon. This is important because it sends his position, his location, through a satellite network to the search and rescue personnel who are responsible for finding him. Afterwards, once he's safely turned on all of his beacons, he has several different forms of beacons, then he can start to worry about water rationing, food rations, am I injured, and managing his situation within the life raft.
Even with flight tracking systems and emergency locator beams, it's possible that the pilot may need to survive in the ocean for several days as search and rescue teams are deployed. The life-saving techniques include how to escape from a submerged aircraft, and of course, how to escape from underneath a parachute. The challenge for the pilot is then how to inflate and survive in a small life raft and wisely use food rations alongside a desalination kit. As the prototype Solar Impulse 1 flew in 2013, the pilots were reminded of how close to the technical boundaries these innovations are. The emergency training should never be needed, but this careful planning and practice gives them a solid plan as they embark on this global adventure.